enough to know this thing on the screen behind me? So I thought. So I grew up in the era where Saturday Night Live was the best TV show ever. You stayed home on Saturday nights, and I'm finding it funny because it's kind of like fashion that all comes back again. Like, it's back again. Are you, anybody here stay home and like watch Saturday Night Live on Saturdays? Nobody? Really? I've got a son in college and he like calls me like, are you watching this right now? Anyways, this is Stuart Smalley, and he was pretty famous back in the day. So I am the first of speakers, and as he mentioned, the other people that are speaking are awesome, because when they first asked me, I checked them out, and I just want to be Facebook friends with them. They're really great. And that Victoria Brown, the one that's the book designer, she's not just designing books, they're limited editions, and I think she's selling at the Victoria Museum.
Yeah, Victoria Albert.
Yeah, Victoria Albert Museum, which is impossible to get into. I had one product get in there once, and they didn't even reorder, and my heart was broken. It's like really tough to get in there. So pretty prestigious people that you've got speaking. So I'm the first person in the series, and I'm probably a good person to start out because I'm very practical. I work in Chicago. I remain somewhat local because I'm also a mother. So I definitely have the true entrepreneurial spirit, but mine is kind of reined in. I can't quite be designing skateboards and stuff quite yet. So in deciding what I should talk about today, I'm going to cover four quick lessons. And then I'm going to give you a few action plan things at the end. Oh, I didn't do that right. Hold on. How do you make it big again? L? Thank you. So I'm going to show you a music video. How about sound? You think it'll have sound? Wait, let's try this.
At a certain point, this guy came up to the campsite. So I guess he was drinking on acid or something.
You can't really hear him, can you?
Making sure that, and he had this big, like warm, 24-ounce, like Miller High Life in his hands. And then he kept talking about like his whiskey, like, oh, my whiskey is so good, it's awesome. And he would like hand it to us and we'd pretend to drink it and be like, oh, it's great.
Did you guys hear that?
Whiskey is so good. And the last thing we heard him say when he walked away was like, how the spooky wagons. And we were like, did he say spooky wagons? Is that a weird? And so that night we ended up all giving each other like campfire Indian guides' names. And one of my friends was Spooky Wagons, and I was Shaky Graves, and there's Spinster Jones and Solomon Doors. And my friend's little brother was asleep in the tent at the time, so we named him Droopy Wieners. And he came out with a really displeased because we all had cool names and he was Droopy Wieners. But that night ended up kind of taking my guitar out and playing for people for the first time in a long time back in Texas. It went great. It was just like this musical explosion. And afterwards, this drunk dude came up and was like, what's your fucking name, man? What's your name? And I decided to stick with it. It was like Shaky Graves. And I told, I guess, a few people that night. And so the next night, people said, hey, what's up, Shaky? I was like, yeah, it's that's okay.
Thank you.
wall. Snake plague fell down the hall. We go on to Chapel Hill. Oh, I'm in real fast. But hurry up. Took my money back and made my run. Well, books, cover, all in the red. Yeah, go pull this bus over and then look dead. Yeah, goodbye. This bus down the next on the cliff where that good grass grows until the chocolate came along. One sunny day, to burn my crops, walk me away. Girl, I need good, young and qualified. Got a date with that general in late July.
Close to as good as him. My children play guitar. We come from a very musical family. So I do some research on this guy, and I find out he's like maybe 3 or 4 years into his career. And he's going to be really big, by the way. You're going to be paying a lot of money to see him about 2 years from now. He started out in New York City. He went to like design school for a while. It wasn't working. He wanted to do something else. And he went to open mic nights. And apparently, I've like Google stalked him. He bombed, you know. He played a couple songs. The crowd kept talking. They were drinking. No one was really listening to him. He'd go back the next week. He'd try to change things up a little bit. He'd get louder. He'd bring a different guitar. No one would listen to him. It went on for about a year, and then he moved to LA because he thought, well, I'm going to try acting now because this guitar thing's not really out so great. So he started taking some acting classes. He got some mentors. He got a couple like little small parts in some indie films where he was actually like playing the guitar and had like two lines in a movie. Along the way, he met a mentor who started talking to him about timing and how when he was playing the guitar, if he was performing, he had to slow things down, had to pick things up, he had to add silence in the song, he needed to pace it different. And so Shaky, which by the way is not his name, Shaky starts to, over a period of time, get his rhythm down and get his groove and starts to notice, he just starts to do open mic nights in LA. And then people, he's noticing like he does something and all of a sudden the crowd stops talking and they look up. And you know, he's taking note of this. So I find his path almost identical to an entrepreneurial path or my path or your path. You could consider yourself very similar. His, you know, his age is probably about the same as yours, where, you know, he just gets out there and he's not really sure what he's doing and he's fumbling around a little bit and he's trying some things and it's not working out perfectly. I find the graphic design is very similar to this. So it's 2.5 years later since he starts his entrance into the music world. And he was cited now by NPR Music as one of the top 10 national artists that music fans should have known in 2013. Oops, did I go too many? There you go. So I'm going to give you a couple true stories. One is, I'm about your age. I was taking classes at the American Academy. And I'm not exactly sure how I'm going to get my next job. Am I going to be an entrepreneur? Am I going to be self-employed? Am I going to try to seek employment through somebody else? And I did a lot of research and I sought out a graphic designer. And she was pretty prominent in the city, and I won't mention any names. She was about my age where I am now, and I was your age. And I had really decided, like, I'm going to work for her. She just had the right design style. She had the right clients. I had seen her around town. She was winning a whole bunch of awards. And this lady really would not give me the time of day. If I called her office, I got screened at the receptionist. There was no email at the time. I sent my resume many times. I tried to get a portfolio appointment. And it was really going nowhere. So I decided I was just going to find her. So I went to her address on Institute Place with my portfolio, which, by the way, your portfolios, I work at Acon, your portfolios are awesome. My portfolio at this time was like this big and had like a handle on the top of it and was enormous. So I knew where, I knew what suite her office was located in. I got in the elevator, and it was such a fancy building, there was actually an elevator man. And I said to him, I would like to meet this name. And he said, oh yeah, you know, she actually just left. She went to lunch. And I said, you know what? I'm just gonna ride the elevator up and down here until she gets in, and then I want you to nudge me. This is a true story. I really only had to wait for about 20 minutes, and I just made chit-chat with people, like getting in and out. At some point, the elevator door opens, and this woman walks in with a big fur coat, and he nudges, and I'm like, oh shit, really? It's this one? So I did my spiel. I said, listen, I just have to tell you the truth. My name is Kelly. I'm a design student. I'd really like to work for you. I've been waiting in the elevator. And she was really great. She's like, come on in. Wow, that's crazy. I've never had anybody do this. So I made it through. I made it past receptionist. I got down. I opened my portfolio, which was probably just like yours. I didn't know who I was. I had paintings in there. I had line drawings in there. I had photography in there. I had some graphic design pieces. And she was very nice. She kind of looked through everything. She gave me about 10 minutes. And she said, I have to be honest with you. I'm going to give you an internship just because you rode up and down the elevator with me. But I can't pay you because you can't do anything for me that earns money. You don't know enough about typography. You can't make me any funds. I can't send you to a client meeting. And I said, fine, I'll take it. That's great. So I started the next week, and she was 100% right, but it was great. I was working with some other graphic designers. I quickly learned I knew nothing about type. So I, being the entrepreneur that I am, I went to, there wasn't even Craigslist at the time, so I went to the Reader, and I found a night shift in a type house. And the shift started at 11 p.m. and ended at 3. So I was coming here, taking classes at the American Academy. I was then working Crate and Barrel, like this one on Wabash, folding towels perfectly in little right angles and putting them in cubicles. I was interning for her 3 days a week, and then I took this night shift in a type house. I probably survived about 4 or 5 months doing this. By the time that internship ended, I knew more about type than any of her designers there, and I was very proud of that. So I think as an entrepreneur, if you're going to go out there and seek a job, you really just have to be committed to learning, doing, rolling with it, and it's not going to be easy. I wish I could tell you that it was, but it's really not easy, but it's pretty fun. It is pretty fun. A little bit later, I'm going to lecture you on just getting out there, but before I do that, I want to make sure that, I'm going to push you to be crazy, and I'm going to tell you places to go and stuff. But I think it all has to be a little bit of moderation, because at the phase that you are right now, you would be really good to invest some time. And it took me a couple years to figure this out, to figure out who exactly you are. Because you're all going to have lots of different skills, like I did too. I could have maybe been a photographer. I could have maybe been an illustrator. But I call it having dates with yourself. So I still do it to this day. You know, I did it when I was your age. I did it in my 30s. I'm not going to give you my age now. But there's some nights, and you will just kind of know when you're in this place where you just maybe need to stay in on a Friday or a Saturday and really do some soul searching, do some reading, figure out, well, what is my best skill? Out of all the different things that I'm doing at this school, what's the one that I think that's the skill that I might have to give back? Do I tend to be leaning more towards graphic design? Do I tend to be more towards illustration? Do I tend to maybe like web coding better? So, what I would do is, once, it took me a while to kind of sort out, and I've met some of your students, and half of them are fabulous at this, and half of them are not. So this is one of my lessons, this is like lesson two that I wanted to give you today, is if you figure out what your skill is that you think that you're doing the best, I suggest in today's market of social media, and today's market of being so difficult, the competition is so rough out there, I would kind of brand yourself. So think of yourself like you are Shaky Graves. And maybe your name is Josephine, and you might want to brand yourself and just call yourself Josie. I would like to encourage you to apply it to different things, like maybe your website is Josie, maybe your business card is Josie. And think of yourself as you, the person, as an entrepreneur, you are now a brand. You are much like Shaky Graves. So his name is not Shaky Graves, but through his 2 years of soul searching and failing and stumbling and doing open mic nights and having nobody listen to him and then going to LA, he started to get it. You know, he started to think, well, my name Alejandro is really not working. So he came up with what I want to call a shtick, you know? it probably took them a long time to figure out how to wrap a handkerchief around that tambourine and then hit it with his foot. And then he has the drum thing. He probably shopped for a long time at a bunch of different thrift stores to find like that perfect retro suitcase and that little retro amp that he's got. So that process, that 2 to 3 years that it took him, Alejandro, to turn into Shaky Graves, he got the story, got the friends. He branded himself brilliantly. He's phenomenal. So I guess my lesson is sort of think that way about yourself. I'm not sure any of this is making any sense, by the way. You can tell me after the lecture. Lesson number 3 is, thanks for the email. Sure, I can assist with that. I will get back to you no later than tomorrow. I grew up in a house of boys, so I am one of 4 children, and I am the only girl. And I grew up in the Midwest, and for us, our whole life revolved around football. You were mostly Cleveland Browns, because I'm a Midwest born and bred Ohio girl. So there was this term in the house that my brothers always did, and it's called duck and weave. And I don't know if you've ever heard that. It's kind of a quarterback term. So, you know, they have to, the catch, and then on the split second, they have to decide like, oh, there's a hole over there. I got to duck. I got to weave. I got to go this way. So my brothers like would get so animated, they hop up off the couch when they did a play and they'd be like, oh my God, did you see what he did? You know. I feel like my life as a graphic designer in this era is so duck and weave. This year alone, I had to learn paperless post. Like if you would have told me 10 years ago I was gonna do something in paperless post, you'd be like, are you kidding me? I'm a senior designer. I had to learn MailChimp, templates. I had to learn batch processing in Photoshop, which I used to give to my interns to do. I had to learn to trick my computer into allowing 2 different Dropbox accounts because I have 2 companies and I was going insane. I had so many files. So I had to go in the back office of Dropbox in order to get 2 accounts to show up on my screen. I had to design 2 client books in Shutterfly, that software that like your mom orders your Christmas greeting cards in. And this year I can now actually code in PHP. So for some reason, our field, due to technology constantly changing, is so duck and weave. So you guys are taking all these different various classes and you're gonna have this set of skill banks and these computer skills that you're gonna know. Most likely, you're probably better than me in a lot of these software skills. But what I'm here to tell you is, you're gonna have to duck and weave, like constantly. So I'm gonna give you a couple stories and then it'll make more sense. And these are all true stories. So the first is about 3 years ago, I was doing a high profile corporate identity for a bank downtown. It's exactly up my line of out. That's exactly my sort of forte. So I do kind of high-end, really refined design in the furniture market, in the lighting market, and this bank sort of lent itself because they were very conservative and it was a very kind of elegant logo. So I did the logo, perfect, that's what I do. I did their print branding, so I did their newsletter and their brochure and their letterhead, perfect, that's what I do. They asked me to aid in their website, so I did all their website templates, but then they hired it all off. I think they had it all coded in India. And then they came to me one day and said, oh, you know, we want our secure bank forms that we send to our clients to fill out, their PDFs, but we want them to be able to actually fill them out online, but we need them to be completely encrypted and coded. And I said, oh, yeah, sure, I can assist with that. I'll get back to you tomorrow. I sort of calculated what the budget was probably going to be for this project. I called the Mac Academy and said, okay, I need a crash course. I need to be able to do PDF encrypted forms. And I signed up. They did a custom class for me. It was like $700 or $800. It was like 7 or 8 hours. It wasn't bad. But I billed the bank like $3,500. So I was smart enough as an entrepreneur to figure out, well, this is going to make sense. So I said, like, yeah, no problem, I can do that for you. Why don't you give me one as a test, and then let's set up a meeting next week and I'll come in and sit down and talk with you. I took their one test, I brought it to the Mac Academy. I did my 1 day crash course. That's a duck and weave. A second story is I was working on a non-for-profit, and it was an annual report, and they gave me a folder of a whole bunch of photography, and it was terrible. So I knew my annual report was not going to have good visual assets. So I was kind of bummed out. Tried to encourage them if we could do a photo shoot. You know, I gave them a couple ideas of some stuff we could do. And they said, oh, you know, I just don't, we're a not-for-profit. We'd have to go to the board. I really don't think they'd give us a budget for a photo shoot. You know, how much would that be? So I kind of highballed this really high price that I knew they couldn't afford. And they said, you know, no, I don't think that's going to work. Right, you know. So I said, well, what if I shot it for you? You know, $1,000? Does that sound okay? And they're like, really? You would do that for us? I'm like, yeah, I'll shoot it for you, $1,000. No problem. I went to Wolf Camera. I found the exact Nikon camera I wanted and the one lens that I could afford for a budget of $1,000. And I bought it. And I shot their whole annual report. And it was great. It won 5 awards that year. So that was a duck and weave. So basically, the client just bought the camera for me, which now I use every single day. Great duck and weave. I have a junior, third story, is I have a junior designer who works for me now. She's charming. She's just like you guys. I can't wait for the day that she works for me. Like, every Tuesday, I'm all excited to see her. So she's hilarious. She's doing the same thing that I was doing, working like 3 jobs. She works for Oprah 2 days a week. She freelances at home, and she works for me 2 days a week. So she comes in last week, you know, saying something like, oh my God, I just accepted this job. It's like WordPress. Like, what's it? Which, I don't know, maybe, I hope they're not teaching WordPress here. But it's like the cheesy web design software. She's like, it's WordPress. Like, what am I going to do with that? I'm like, girl, just get on YouTube. Like, you can learn that. So a week later, she came back in, and she's like, oh my God, you're right. I took that job. I learned WordPress. I've like opened a YouTube video on the left, opened a new WordPress file on the right. I would just like click back and forth. I opened a third page and would type like, how do I change picture box sizes in WordPress? And so she did it. She did a duck and weave. She's very entrepreneurial. So in this era, which is very different than the one I grew up in, to be an entrepreneur or to be self-employed, you really got to duck and weave every minute. Did I skip one? No. That was so hilarious, I forgot half my papers. That's fine. Oh, I'm just gonna wing it, sorry about that. So I want to give you some action plan ideas that if I were in your shoes right now. The first is I would have a website regardless of what your particular major is in school. So I've worked those ACON groups here and I've had some of the students that come up and speak and they're pretty good at that, I do have to say. The ones that aren't, I would encourage you to find someone who's studying web design and team up because your website could be a project for the website major's portfolio. And I probably interview maybe once a month for a different job. Sometimes it's a freelance job. Sometimes it's someone we're hiring in-house just for a couple months because we have a heavy workflow. Sometimes it's someone that we're hiring full-time. And the first thing I do, they send me an email, cover letter, resume, website. I go straight to the website first. It's just today's market. We're so digital these days. And I almost feel like I can understand that potential person interviewing with me. I feel like I can understand their logic and their organization as well as just looking at their work. How is it easy to navigate around? I feel like I understand how they think before I even interview them. So that's my action plan number one, and that's a long project. So websites, definitely you think, oh, it really can't be that hard to just knock one out. I'm sure in WordPress you're probably knock one out pretty fast. But to have a really well-navigated, thought-out, clean, professional one, it really does take a little bit of time. And you have to do a couple things that don't work so well, and you tweak them and you change them. Number two, as a student, I would join AIGA hands down as a student member. First of all, the rates are probably closer to like $50 a year, which Christmas is coming up. I would encourage all of you to ask your parents for Christmas. Like, don't buy me those hunter boots I've been talking about. Really buy me an AIGA membership, because there are unlimited resources, national and international. So you can find events to go to on a weekly basis that typically for students, I'll be like, your admission will be $5, $6, $7, and many are free. There are so many different educational resources. There is a whole posting for internships, free jobs, summer jobs, maybe you want to fly somewhere else and look for a job. Later, when you become a professional like me and you want to be an AIGA member, it costs an arm and a leg and it drives me crazy. And then every event I want to go to, it costs a lot more money. So definitely join as a student. And maybe even when you graduate, you don't even have to tell AIGA that you've graduated. You're still going to have your card. Just keep renewing it all the way until some employer offers you a membership. I would just milk it as long as you can. Number three, and this is very interesting, and I just tried this with a couple of different accounts, and then I tried it with one of my companies. I would encourage, once you brand yourself, or you're working on your brand, or you're trying to figure out what is your shtick as an entrepreneur, what is your look? What is your name? Are you Josie.com or whatever you are? I would set up a MailChimp account. It's so stupid and it's so easy and it's free. So it's just one of those template email accounts. You can do a canned template that's already there. You can do a custom template if you want. If you're a web coder, you can code the whole thing and then bring it into MailChimp if you want something completely different. But even if you have no coding skills in any way, shape, or form, all of you in the room, and me included, who just learned it this year, you can all set up a MailChimp account. And what I'd do is, I would first add all of my friends. I'd add all of my colleagues here at school. I would add my teachers. I would, when I'm out and about, and I'm going around town and meeting people, I would start to add them. I would collect some business cards, and maybe once a week, like every Friday morning, you just sit down at MailChimp and like enter more people in your subscription list. As you travel, which I'll talk to you in a couple minutes, when you're like out in the city and you're meeting people, I would just start, what you're basically doing is you're building a data bank of people that like you. So you're building, again, this brand identity. And then it's up to you to decide how you then want to reach out to them via MailChimp. So it's just an email they're going to get. Some people might want to be psychotic and send an email every week, but then most likely I'll be a little over the top. You might only want to send something once every 6 months. You might want to send something once every quarter. But it can just be, maybe it's a class project that you just finished that you really love. You can just upload a picture there and just write something about it. But it's one way of you starting to formulate this way of people understanding who you are and what you're doing and just keeping it in front of them. It's a different method. Most of you probably Facebook or tweet. So it's a little bit an interesting, different, more professional level to do the same thing. The fourth action step I have for you is, I think that this city as a resource is phenomenal. And there are so many free things that you can do. And because you're geographically located on Michigan Avenue, it's so easy for you to just walk out the door and get one of those venture cards and hop on the bus and go anywhere, or you've got the LSTAT like right behind you. So I'm on this advisory board at the school, and I keep encouraging them to have these field trips, and everyone is just looking at me like, this girl is whacked. But you will get inspired if you step out of this school. I know you're in this giant think tank right now, so you think, I need to stay in here, I need to stay in the hub, we're all designing together and working with each other. But by you actually getting on the bus and going up to the MCA every Tuesday night, I think you would get reinvigorated. So entrepreneurs and us crazy self-employed people are constantly looking for things that feed us and fuel us and keep us moving. So I will many times take a half a personal day off. Sometimes I take a whole day off, but that's really hard. Sometimes I will just block out of my whole calendar and not go to work for 5 or 6 hours, because I can tell, like, I'm not able to crank out the creative energy, or my projects aren't up to the par that I'd like them to be. And I just so easily understand I'm just drained, because part of being an entrepreneur is you constantly have to just throw out ideas, and you have to throw out all this energy, and you gotta refuel. And people refuel in all different ways. So one great way is you can be a little bit more of an introvert, so you can go into a library and you can read stuff. Be a little bit more of an extrovert. Some people like to go out and dance and listen to music. Sometimes I have to do that. But there are so many resources in this city, and I can't say enough about the Museum of Contemporary Art. I just cannot say enough. So I typically, well, now I'm a mom, so I can't go as frequently as I used to, but I used to go every single Tuesday night. Tuesday's the free day, so you don't have to pay admission to go. So as students, I think your classes get off around 3, is that right, Duncan? You kind of wind up around 3. You could go to the MCA, and from 3 to 5, you could just look at whatever their installation is. I just drove by the other day because I was dropping my daughter at something, and there's this huge head in front, like as big as this whole room. I have no idea what it is. So I'm just gonna give you a couple, 4 instances. So next Tuesday, they have somebody who's studying, she's in like the cinema arts organization in Brooklyn, and she has an interactive seminar where, without using a video camera or without using a camera, you make an animated film. I have no idea how you're going to do that. No, I have no clues. She talked to us something about, like, you're going to do some scratching, but my thought was, what the heck's that? And why would you not go? It's free. So you could go down there, you could look at the whole exhibit, then you could do this interactive thing. You're gonna talk to this girl who's from Brooklyn. She's probably gonna have all these interesting people. She's gonna have some resources. You're gonna take her card. You're gonna add her to your MailChimp account. You're gonna get some idea that you weren't expecting because your professor gave you an assignment that starts next week, but you're kind of stumped because you don't know what it's gonna be, but probably something that you're gonna see hanging on the wall in the MCA. You're gonna look at it and go, oh, and you're gonna get an idea for a class. The week after that, it was, so this is like Tuesday, November 18th, there's a filmmaker, and she is like architecturally and politically like an activist, so I think hers is more of a film screening. So you're just gonna, I think you just go down and maybe you watch it, and then there's 4 or 5 people, and it's all an interactive discussion afterwards. So there's also events. You guys know these things because you can log on Time Out Chicago and just click on the button that says free things. There's also this place I go to a lot called The Hideout, which is a bar, which you're underage, so maybe you can't get in. But there's certain nights, it's usually once a week, But they also have these free events that you can, it's any age appropriate. They do book readings, they do art shows, they do, for a while they had something called Doodle Ganza that's been traveling around Chicago where you go there and you literally just doodle and you draw for about an hour and a half. So part of being an entrepreneur and part of being self-employed is you're just out there all the time. You just continually go to things and expose yourself and see new things and hand out your business card. And if I was going to the MCA next Tuesday, I'd bring my business cards and I'd think, oh wow, maybe I wouldn't mind doing some work for that animator, that Brooklyn-based animator. So that's pretty much my speech. In conclusion, for me, speaking on being an entrepreneur, I would say be a little bit stupid, get yourself out there in order to get your first job, which is not going to be easy. You might have to take 2 or 3 different jobs. That's fine, because then you'll find out for yourself what you like and what you don't like. My intern right now who's working for me, the one I mentioned that's also working for Oprah, she was elated when she got the Oprah job. She was so excited. That's kind of a big name to work for. It's a great resume filler. And after 1 month, when she came into my office on her work days, she sat down and she said, I'm so glad I took that Oprah job because now I know what I don't want to do. Now I know I really want to be a graphic designer. You know, I know I'm only here a couple days a week, but the projects you give me and the solutions that I'm asked to come up with, they fit me. Like this is, they fit me. But I would not have known that had I not taken the Oprah job. Brand yourself. I help my interns do this. I help my coworkers do this. I help my clients do this. I do this for myself every day. I'm constantly trying to figure out how to make my brand better. So as a graphic designer, I have a little niche of I'm high-end, I'm fashion-based, constantly redesigning my website. I hate my website right now. I gotta do it again. I own a second company that's a children's product design company, which I love. Completely different branding, like night and day. You'd think I'm schizophrenic. I couldn't even brand that company. I hired one of your students. So my logo for my second company, which is called The Urban Infant, I use Brando. Do you remember him? Brando was perfect. Brando branded himself so well that when I came to Akon, I totally got it. I was looking for something really simplistic, something really clean, something monochromatic, and Brando had branded himself and was showing, his website was organized, his business card was organized. I got what his skill set was and I hired him. So he did my logo for The Urban Infant, which is far better than anything I could have done. It was phenomenal. Duck and Weave is make the most of all of the software skills that these teachers are teaching you, as well as your fundamental skills as well. Draw on paper. My two youngest junior designers, when I give them an assignment, they go directly to the computer. And I actually have to turn to them and say, shut down the computer for at least an hour. And why don't you talk through with me what your goal is for a couple minutes, maybe write through what is the solution you're trying to provide, and do some sketching, and then you can turn your computer. They all do Google image searching. They do a little bit of research. Some of them launch straight, they just like open Illustrator right away, and I'm like, whew, step back. So take advantage of the fundamentals your teacher is teaching you. Take advantage of all the skilled classes, like the software skills that they're teaching you. But then also know when you graduate, probably on a quarterly basis, you're gonna have to learn another software skill. And most likely you're gonna keep changing. I would guess in 2014, I'm probably going to have to learn like two or three other different software skills. I'm actually asking Duncan right now if I can like go back and audit a couple classes, because I really need to learn Drupal. Anybody, are you teaching Drupal? No. And last is, make some action plans if you do want to be an entrepreneur. Just literally make some action plans, like, I would like to have a website, and that's probably going to take me 6 months. So make the steps backward. Find a web student here that I like, that I can work with. They're kind of fun. What's going to be my content on the website? Start to organize it. That's a nightmare. You know, gather all your photos. You got to size them all the same size and shape. So I would do that as an action plan. I would look into MailChimp and decide, do I want to brand myself and start to do some sort of a MailChimp account? Maybe you want to join AIGA. Maybe you want to join other organizations. Just Google around. There's so many other ones as well. And start going to timeout maybe once a month, clicking on the little button that says free events, and just starting to go out there. And there's many more things. I have many more things too, but so I'm prepared for today. Yeah. Am I supposed to be open for questions?
Sure. Any questions? If anybody has any questions, can they come up and ask you?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So thanks, everybody. Let's thank Kelly again for her time today.